Fantastic. So it's lovely to be here. And I want to thank you for inviting me, Pastor. And I have seen some very wonderful signs of ministry Amen. Happening here. Amen. I sat down there this morning and received a word for myself.
Amen.
You know, a prophetic word. And that is very important in the church. Amen. Because there are gifts that the Holy Spirit gives to Christians. Amen. And the Bible says those gifts are given to profit us.
Hallelujah.
So it has been given to us so that we might get some kind of profit from it. And that word profit means to be better. Mm-hmm. So it means that when God gives us a word like that, it's to better our lot in life. I'm very glad that I've received something already.
Hallelujah.
I've received something already in this place.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Now, the Bible tells us that God in his wisdom has decided to save people by the foolishness of preaching. So some of the things I'm going to say may not make sense. You can check that out in 1 Corinthians in chapter 1 and verse 21. By the foolishness of preaching, God has decided to save many. So in a sense, I am a preacher. So I have come with foolish words. And those foolish words are geared to save. Mm-hmm. And the word save there is to deliver.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? So don't mind me if you don't, if what I'm saying to you doesn't sound logical.
Mm-hmm.
It is just how God has made it.
Mm-hmm.
It is not my word, it's the word of God.
Hallelujah.
Okay? And I pray that he will give us understanding as we have prayed earlier on.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now, exactly 7 years ago, I came into this country. Exactly 7 years ago. The reason why I came was because some few years before that, God gave my wife a vision. And the vision was that my wife saw myself and herself preaching the gospel somewhere. And when she told me about that vision, I said, yes, I'm a pastor. I preach, so it's nothing special about that. He said, no. That where I saw you preaching was a place that had white sand. The sand on the floor was white. I've never seen white sand before. Yeah. And he said we were wearing big coats in that place. I said, okay, I have no clue about what you're saying, but I know God is going to enlighten us.
Amen.
For it to be clear. A few years later, I had a vision myself. And I had a vision of the map of the world. You know this world atlas kind of map? That is round, that you put on your office decks. I saw that map in front of me. And it was rolling, it was spinning around. And all of a sudden it stopped. And I saw Great Britain. And within a very small part of it, I saw a place called York. And I was confused. Yeah? And I went away from that vision. I started asking people who I knew lived in England about a place called York. Guess what? They don't know it. It was shocking. Nobody knew where York was. Because most of my people think that when you talk about Great Britain, you're talking about London. And any city that doesn't have a premiership team does not exist. So York doesn't have a premiership team. So nobody knows York. People know Manchester, Leeds,
Liverpool.
Yeah. But nobody knows York. So it was a challenge for me. I couldn't interpret what the Lord was showing me. But later I met a man that lives in Sheffield and does ministry in Sheffield. That's Pastor Bako. He came over to Lagos, and I was asking him certain questions. I said, do you know a place called York? Yeah. I said, I don't mean New York. No. He told me, listen, I live in South Yorkshire. That's in Sheffield. And York is in North Yorkshire. That was the way he explained it. I said, so it exists there. Then I realized God was calling us into that city. And I asked him if he could facilitate that for me. And he tried as much as he could. But the interesting thing was that when we came in to York, myself and my wife, we arrived at the station, came down from the train, a man ran towards us, was running towards us. A man who was in his 60s, was about 62 years old then. So he was running like that, well-dressed, smartly dressed like our pastor here. And was running towards us, and I was scared. Why was he coming to us? I told my wife, listen, look at this guy, he's coming towards us. He's coming straight at us. And he just stood in front of us. He said, hello, good afternoon. His voice is very, very deep. He said, good afternoon. I said, good afternoon. He said, you must be Reuben.
Wow.
I said, yes. He said, can I have your bags, please?
Wow.
And he took our bags. I started to run again. I looked at my wife, and my wife looked at me. I said, let's go after this guy. Because we have no clue what he's up to. And we went after him, got to the car park. He opened his boot, threw our bags in the boot, and looked at me and smiled. He said, I know you may be wondering, what's this guy up to? I said, yes. He said, get into the car first. You know, prior to my coming, I heard people say that the United Kingdom is a place where you have a lot of secret agents. So I thought that this guy was one of them. Yeah? So while we got into the car, we were just doing what we were told. We sat down in the car and he started his story. He said, 21 years ago, then, God spoke to his heart to build a chalet at the back of his house. That a missionary will come to York from Africa.
Wow.
That when he comes, make sure, use your life to ensure that his ministry succeeds.
Wow.
So the previous day, I listened, and we are looking at what is this guy saying. So I asked him, so how do you know it's me? He said, So last night he woke me up, told me you were coming.
Wow.
So your name is Reuben. And I asked him, Lord, how do I know he's the one? He said, don't worry. He's very dark. You can't miss him. So you want to hear my story? That is my story in a nutshell. I say that to you just to prove to you that God exists.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
It transcends culture.
Yeah.
It transcends traditions.
Yeah.
Amen. And is not limited by location.
Yes.
Okay? So God exists. Now God exists so that we may exist in Him.
Amen.
Yeah? How many of you like the world as it is today? How many of you love the world as it is today? I certainly don't. In fact, coming to the Western world, I thought that there will be no problem whatsoever in this part of the world. Trust me. The problems I have encountered here are worse than the problem I used to encounter in Africa. The problem I encounter here is a problem of uncertainty. In Africa, at least there is certainty. At least you know you cannot do much. So you are satisfied with what you have. You are content. But here, you have this funny idea that you can do so much. So when you are where you are just not satisfied. Mm. Yeah. So this plagues our hearts, and it makes us fall sometimes into depression. And we absolutely do not know what we are doing anymore. So the world is not in a good shape. But the question is why? Why is the world not in a good shape? And my business here this morning is to just make you understand a little bit why the world is not in a good shape. And to tell you that it will be all right with you.
Amen.
Because you have God in your life.
Amen.
Yeah? So turn with me, if you will, to the second book of Kings. 2 Kings, chapter 6. I'll read from verse 8 to 18. 2 Kings, chapter 6. I'll read from verse 8 to 18. And it reads, "Now the king of Aram was at war with Israel. After conferring with his officers, he said, 'I will set up my camp in such and such a place.' Then the man of God sent word to the king of Israel, 'Beware of passing that place, because the Arameans are going down there.' So the king of Israel checked on the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elijah warned the king so that he was on his guard in such places. This enraged the king of Aram. He summoned his officers and demanded of them, 'Tell me which of us is on the side of the king of Israel.' 'None of us, my lord the king,' said one of his officers. 'But Elisha, the prophet who is in Israel, tells the king of Israel the very words you speak in your bedroom.' Mm. 'Go find out where he is,' the king ordered, so I can send men and capture him. The report came back, he is in Dothan. Then he sent horses and chariots and a strong force there. They went by night and surrounded the city. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early in the morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. 'Oh, my lord,' he said, 'what shall we do?' 'Don't be afraid,' the prophet answered. 'Those who are with us are more than those who are with them.' And Elijah prayed, 'Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see.' Then the Lord opened the eyes opened the servant's eye, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire are all around Elisha. And the enemy came down toward him. Elijah prayed to the Lord, 'Strike this army with blindness.' So he struck them with blindness, as Elisha had asked." May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Amen.
Amen.
Now, there is such a thing as spiritual intelligence. Yeah? Spiritual intelligence. You know the MI5 and the MI6? They give to the government security intelligence. So our safety as a nation is largely dependent on the effectiveness of their work. So if the enemies are coming from outside, or even if the enemies are located from within, the MI5 and the MI6, they put their acts together and communicate that intelligent information to the government, who will checkmate the enemy's enterprise. Yeah? So security is largely a compromise where there is no intelligence. Where there is no intelligence. That is why we must be grateful for the things, for the work of our security services. Because this country is so protected than what we can see. They do a very, very important work day in, day out. That is why we don't hear the kind of atrocities and destruction that we hear in other places around Europe. It's not just happening. It's because of intelligence report. Yeah, it's because of intelligence report. Now, I say this because there are several ways that Christians have been described in Scripture. One of the ways they were described is that we are sheep and we have a shepherd. Yeah? Another way we have been described is that we are ambassadors. I like that one. Mm-hmm. I like that one because when I was a child, I've always dreamt of being a diplomat. I've always wanted to be an ambassador because of the privileges they enjoy. The reason why that dream came into my heart was one day I was returning from school. I was in primary school then. And there was this car that was parked right in front of the post office. And some security personnel, traffic wardens came. They put a clamp on the wheel of the car. I saw them put the clamp on the car and they left. So when the owner of the car finished from the post office, came out, saw the clamp on the car, he screamed on top of his voice, "Who put this clamp on my car?" And this traffic wardens rushed out. "We are the ones who did it. You are parking in the wrong place." And the guy looked straight at them and said, "Take it off. I'm a diplomat, for God's sake." You know what he was trying to say? I'm above the law. I have diplomatic immunity. Can't you see the plate, the registration number of the car? You are not allowed to clamp the car. So when the Bible refers to us as Christian ambassadors on the earth, what it's simply saying is that the system of this world cannot hold us captive. Because of the immunity we have. Because of the immunity we have in Christ Jesus. Because of the Bible says he is the head of all principalities and powers. So every king and earthly potentate, Christ rules over all. And you are sent to represent him. So it means that if they could not hold him captive, they can't hold you captive.
Amen.
Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yes.
So the Bible describes us as ambassadors. But the one that really gets to me is the way it describes us as soldiers. He said we are soldiers of Christ. We are military personnel. We are in the army of God. In other words, we are on the earth to fight a battle on behalf of our God. And you know, he has equipped us for this battle. So it is very, very crucial that as a Christian, you realize that we are at war. We are at war. And this war is not such that you fight with bow and arrows. The Bible says the weapon of our warfare are not carnal. So they are not physical weapons. They are spiritual weapons we fight with. Okay? So in the church in this country, for example, people are scared to preach about three things: hell, sin, and warfare. The reason is because we feel that everything we see is normal. Is normal. People just do what they want to do because they want to do it. No. There is always a spiritual reason why people act the way they act. For example, in my city in the last 2 years, we have had 7 deaths of young university students. 7. Now, the first one happened because this lady went out at night with her friends. And they went to a club. And they drank, and they were drunk. And all of them left the club at the same time. They were heading home at the same time. But she was going to somewhere else that was different from her friends, who were equally drunk. So they parted ways at some point. And she now went, and she was walking by the riverbank.
Wow.
And she fell into the river because she thought that the water was hard ground. And she drowned. Wisdom demands that the other students should be careful, isn't it?
Yeah.
The other 6 drowned the same way.
Wow.
They all went out late at night, got drunk, walked by the river, and fell into the river. All drowned the same way. So you begin to ask yourself the question, where is the place of wisdom? Where is the place of wisdom? The answer is not that wisdom is not there. The answer is that there is a devil whose mission is to kill, steal, and destroy. Okay? So understanding that we are in this warfare will put you in a better position to think strategically. And that is where wisdom comes in. That is where wisdom comes in. Now that strategic thinking is fueled by the intelligence information that you have. So the Bible says in Mark chapter 4 and verse 11 and 12, Mark 4 verse 11 and 12, he said, it has been given unto us, Christians, to know the mysteries of the kingdom. He said, but to them that are without, it is not given. So that see, they may see and not understand. Hear, they may hear and not comprehend. So it is our spiritual duty to know what is happening in our space. The Bible says God does not do anything except he communicates the same to his servants, the prophets. So you see why it is important we have the manifestation of spiritual gifts in our midst. Because if God raises up a prophet, he tells us what will happen tomorrow. And by that information, we are able to protect ourselves, apply our hearts to wisdom. Does it make sense?
Yes.
Okay. So we must think warfare. We must think battle. We must think battle. Now, there are two very important principles of combat. Two very important principles. One is to be aware of your enemy. Who your enemy is, you must be aware. The Bible says that we should not be ignorant of the devices of the devil. We should not be ignorant of it. That's 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 11. We should not be ignorant of the devices of the devil. Another translation says we should not be unaware of his schemes. We should be aware. So it means that there are certain things that the devil will orchestrate that looks good, but it's of the devil. Yeah? So when people want to talk about this lovely young people that drowned, they say, oh, they were just having a night out. No, they were not just having a night out. God, the Bible says, doesn't even want a sinner to die. Talk less of taking children, young people, that their parents have so much high hopes on, away abruptly. That is the devil. And the Bible says we should not be ignorant of his schemes. So spiritual intelligence is key to winning the battles of life. We should not be ignorant. He went further to say that we should be sober and be vigilant, because our adversary, the devil, is going around like a roaring lion, is seeking for whom he may devour. He's saying it again, that you should not be ignorant. However, be sober, be alive, be alert. Yeah? Because your adversary is now telling you that you have an enemy. It's your adversary. It's called the devil. He's going around. He's everywhere. He's going around everywhere. He's looking for who he may devour. So again, scripture is telling us that we should be aware. So one of the laws of combat is to be aware of the enemy and who he is. And also to be aware of how you operate. The Bible tells us that the schemes of the devil, they are subtle. They are very subtle. Did God really say you shouldn't eat out of any tree in the garden? Come on, that's not what God said. God said you may eat of all the trees, but not that one. He turns the law of God on his head and makes it acceptable to the senses. And we fall into that trap. And when he captures us, he celebrates. One more person in my camp. So he says that we should be aware of his schemes, how he operates, of his devices. Yeah. But more importantly, in combat, we should be aware of who we are and what we have. Yeah. So if you want to go and fight a battle, if you don't evaluate the weapons you have in your arsenal, if you don't know the capacity of the force of the people that you have, you cannot practically go to battle because you'll be shortchanged. Yeah. So an awareness of who you are, what you have, and your strategies, yeah, puts you at an advantage to have victory in combat. Okay? Now listen to what the Bible says. Many times in scripture we are told, God will say, for example, in Isaiah chapter 41 and verse 10. Isaiah 41 and verse 10. He said, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my right hand of righteousness." Again, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7, he said, "Do not be anxious for nothing." Well, not be anxious about anything. He said, "But in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." So he's saying again, do not be afraid, do not be anxious. He said, "Peace is what I leave with you. It is not my own peace that I give you. I do not give it as the world gives, as God gives it. Do not be worried or upset. Do not be afraid." That is John 14, verse 27. Why is he always telling us not to be afraid? He's telling us this because he's with us. In other words, the battle we are fighting is not all about us, it's all about him. So I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So an awareness of who you are and who's with you puts you in a better standing to confront the enemy. The Bible says we should resist the devil and he will flee away from us. Say, resist him and he will flee. Can I resist the devil? Yes, of course, I can. But not in my strength, because he's with me. So an awareness that God is with us is key to our victory in the battles of life. You know what? When I look at most Christians, they live life as if they are alone. We live life as if we don't have any backing. Do you know what breeds fear? What breeds fear? What actually breeds fear is a sense of loneliness. When I was a child, if I'm in a dark room alone, I'll be afraid. But if I know that my other siblings or my parents are also in the same dark room, I'm not afraid. Can't you see how lonely we have become? And even when we come to church, we tend to be lonely. Everybody's creating this small enclave for themselves. And we don't know that that is also a strategy of the devil. Because what the devil does is to separate us. Because when the enemy separates you, he can destroy you one after the other. That is why when people go to war, they go in a platoon. They don't go individually. They go in a platoon. You know. So God has blessed the church with grace. That is why I said the church is a body. My head did not stay at home while I was coming here. My head came with me. Anything I will suffer on this journey, the entirety of my body will suffer. So when the church is going to battle, we should go together. Because there are more with us that are out there with them. People always ask the question, why is it that it looks like as if God is not very prominent in our society? I say, no. It's not as if he's not prominent. The church is not together. The church is not together. Do you know, if the church come together, the churches in the UK come together in a prayer meeting, Wembley Stadium will not be able to hold us.
Yes.
Wembley. If the church in this country comes together for an all night of prayer at Wembley, the entire fabric of this society will shake.
Yeah.
Some years ago, we had a dictator in Nigeria.
Yeah.
He was so powerful that no one could do anything to him. So guess what the church did? 5 million people decided to gather together and pray.
Wow.
Nigeria is a country with 200 million people. 5 million of the 200 million gathered together and prayed. Nobody touched the man. He died on his bed.
Yeah.
In his room, he died there. You don't know the power of the weapon that dwells within us. The Bible says, greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. So fear not. The greater one lives inside of you. So Elijah prayed to God on behalf of his apprentice prophet. He said, listen, there are more with us than are with them. And the guy looked around. Since my master is sick here, the only people I can see around us are the enemies. How can we sit down and allow ISIS to take over our nation? And everybody's complaining on here, including Christians. We prayed them out. We disarmed them in the place of prayer. Prayer works.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen.
I was far away in Nigeria and God was speaking to somebody 21 years before I arrived. 21 years before I arrived. I was still in secondary school then.
Wow.
I had no inkling. My ambition while I was in secondary school to be the youngest president of Nigeria. End of story. That was my ambition. I had no other ambition in my life. I'm a very mobile person. At 9, I knew I wanted to work in the finance industry. I was going to work there for 10 years, after which I would go into politics. That was my plan. Very defined plans. Until God called me into ministry. And he made me to understand my dreams of becoming a diplomat and a president. He has made me that. So now I'm an ambassador of Christ.
Amen.
Going up and down the world, communicating the beauty of God's kingdom to the people. So there are more with us. I want you to cheer up. Go out there with confidence.
Amen.
Stop going out there as if you are helpless. You're not. There are more with us than are with them. God has got your back.
Amen.
And guess what? He neither sleeps nor slumbers. He doesn't go on holiday. He doesn't go on vacation. He's there all the time.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
All the time.
Thank you, God.
He's there all the time. All the time, our God is there. So we must come to this awareness, like our pastor was praying the other time about God opening our eyes to see what is available to us. To see what is available to us. Daniel said, it is they that know who their God is that will be strong and do exploits. It is they that know who their God is. That's Daniel chapter 11 and verse 31 and 32. If you know your God and where he is, you know, people will ask me, so where is God? Is God in heaven? I say, yes and no. So what is yes and no? His throne is in heaven, but he dwells with me.
Amen.
For example, as I was coming here today, I didn't leave him at home. He came with me. He's always there with me. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit has been given to all those who believe in him.
Amen.
And guess what the Holy Spirit is? The Greek word for the Holy Spirit is Anos Parakletos. Our regular standby. He's always there. See, I am not a person that has a sense that I'm stranded on earth. I'm not. The Holy Spirit guides me.
Amen.
But somebody who wants to ask, you see, all these things you are saying, yeah, they sound good, but it doesn't work for me. Say, let all men be liars and God be true.
That's right.
He is faithful to keep his word.
Yeah.
Perhaps the reason why it's not happening for you is because you are far from him. You can be close yet far. You know, sometimes I hear people say things like, things are hard in this country, you know. I look at them, hard in this country. If you see hardship, you won't talk. One day I felt healed at home. And I was praying, and my wife looked at me and said, my dear, call 999. I said, what would that do? So they will come and get you. They rang 999. And they told me what to do. And within 5 minutes, they were at my house. Trying to help. And somebody is telling me that things are hard here. Things are hard, yeah? Very hard. Let me tell you. If you don't know, I want you to know today. God has blessed this nation beyond our human imagination. Not America. Not anywhere else. The mystery of God's hand upon this nation is the size of the nation. We are so small, yet we are so big. When I was in primary school, my headmaster was Scottish. He was pouring in God's grace into my life, and I didn't know what he was doing. We are so small, and people talk about this small island. Yes. But we're a great nation. We need to begin to see clearly what the Lord has done here. And when we see that, what it means is that we can take on any obstacle. So what if we leave the European Union? What happened? We are greater than whatever anybody is saying. We can take up the challenges that are coming. Why? God is with us.
Amen.
So church, I want you to arise and have this awareness of combat. Be combat ready. And that readiness demands that you know what is inside. Okay. I may look ordinary, but there is something greater in me.
Amen.
The prophet looks just like any other man, but he said to his apprentice, there are more with us than are with them.
Amen.
In closing.
Amen.
in closing.
Does it mean that if I have all these things, the awareness of the enemy and the awareness of God in my life, if I'm conscious of all these things, does it mean that I will not be afraid? Of course you will. Because you are human. Yeah? But listen to what David said about how he deals with fear. He said, when I am afraid, I put my trust in him.
Amen.
Psalm 56 and verse 3. Psalm 56 and verse 3. When I am afraid, not if I am afraid, when I am afraid, I immediately put my trust in him. So what that means is that I take my worries and my cares and I dump it on him. Yeah? So what that translates into physically is that I'm no longer going to communicate my fear, whether in my actions or in my deeds or in my words. Why? When I'm afraid, I have put my trust in him that is able to save me. He's able to save me. People are very disheartened because of the state of the church. I tell you this, the church is alive.
Amen.
Jesus is moving.
Amen.
He's enlisting more and more people
Amen.
Into his army. And you are one of them.
Amen.
My message this morning to you is this. Be aware.
Amen.
Be conscious.
Amen.
We are not dead people. We are people who are alive.
Amen.
So be aware.
Amen.
Be aware. And we know that God, even our God, will win this battle
Amen.
For us.
Amen.
Can we stand together? Can we hold hands together, if you will? Let's hold hands. Faith is praying with the knowledge that God listens. It's not just praying because that is what we do. It's praying with a consciousness that God listens. Yeah? I was worried coming to this country. Very worried. Worried because, like Abraham, I had no clue of what I was going to meet. I thought, in a sense, that it would be easier for me as a missionary to come into the UK. I haven't lived in Malaysia myself. I haven't taken the gospel into Malaysia myself. So I know that is a majority Muslim country. So most of my friends told me when I was coming to you, that was a Christian nation. I'm telling you the truth, brethren. I have never seen the kind of opposition to the Christian faith like I've experienced here. Not even in Malaysia. In Malaysia, Muslims, we are giving up their houses for us to start fellowships in it. They were coming into our assemblies to help us set up. People who were born Muslims. But it's different here. And the reason why it's different is because people tend not to be aware that there is an enemy that wants to destroy us. That wants to remove the great out of Great Britain. We will not allow it to happen. We'll pray to our God. Said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, if they will forsake their wicked ways, I will heal their land. So I'd like us together to ask for God's mercy over this land. Ask for God's mercy because we have been ungrateful not to recognize how much He has blessed us as a nation. Let's ask for God's mercy to allow revival to spring up in this country again. Let's pray for our leaders that God will fill them with His wisdom to navigate the affairs of this nation to the right path. Let's pray that the church will come alive again, that the wisdom of God will be evident in the church. Let's pray together. Let's pray together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes. Yes, Lord. Do have mercy on us, Lord. Do not allow us to die in our ignorance, Lord. Lord, deliver us from ourselves. Us the urgency of the kingdom. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name we pray. I'd like us in prayer also to give notice to the kingdom of darkness. So listen, you have no place here. We drive you out of this nation. We drive you out of our schools. We drive you out of our institutions. We drive you out of our parliament. We drive you far away from these islands. You have no place here, devil. Get out of this place. Let's give notice in the name of Jesus. You have no place here. You cannot dwell here. You cannot dwell in this place. This is God's highland. We believe in God in this country, the God of heaven and earth. We pursue you out of this place by the power and the blood of Jesus. We come in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Like David brought down Goliath, we are going to bring you down. We prophesy over this nation. It is well with this country.
Amen.
It is well with the families. It is well with the children. It is well with the men and the women. You will not steal our greatness. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
And Father, we submit to you completely. That you may take absolute control of all that concerns us.
Amen.
One of the things we discover from Scripture, Lord, is that you are interested in nations. You said to Abraham that you are going to make him a father of many nations. And we thank God that he has seeds in this nation. And we, the seeds of Abraham, through Jesus Christ our Lord, pray this morning.
Yes, Lord.
That, Lord, you will take control of this nation.
Amen.
We cancel completely every antiques, every enterprise of the evil one in this nation.
Yes.
Every plan to take the heart of our children. Father, we cancel it by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
We come against every plan to extinguish the Christian faith from our public life. And we pray that Jesus, you will reign again.
Amen.
In this land.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
And all will be well.
Yes, Lord.
And your name will be glorified.
Amen.
In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Amen.
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 God bless you. God bless you.